All right, and next up, we have Mr. Andres, who is going to be in the speaker for the day. So, Andres, without any further ado.
Good job.
So I worked for the last 16 years trying to restore the Trinity River for salmon, and so it's a shortage. I'll try to make it quick because I'm not late. So we all know where the Trinity River is, and there's a couple dams on there, flows into the Klamath River and out the ocean. It's been hammered by human impacts from gold mining, dredger mining, logging, dam building. Here's some of the dredger mining. These are pickup trucks for sale. Then they just push the river over and fill the floodplain.
What are they mining for?
Gold. And that's actually a project site right there to try to restore that thing at the bottom of the boat. Okay, then in this 1960 they built the big dam, and the purpose of that dam is to divert water out of the Trinity River, into Whiskey Down, and then into the Sacramento River. And we cut off the border of the watershed above it, so fish can't get up there. So they built a fish hatchery to mitigate for that. The purpose of that dam is to divert water. They diverted 91% of all the water over in the Sacramento River. And what they didn't account for is that when you take that much water out of the river, it totally changes the river, and it made it bad for fish. So this is a photo or a graph of the flows from 1911 to before they built the dam. You can see there's a lot of water in the river, and they built the dam, and that's 90% gone. And then they realize it's hurting the fish, and they start to build it back. So when you take water out of the river and you log the watersheds, the river fills up with sand, essentially. The other thing that happens without floods is the vegetation comes in more so than it should, and basically blocks the river down and makes it kind of a canal, and you have temperature issues. So as a result, there were massive fish declines, upwards of 96%, depending on the species of the salmon. And this is 10 years after the dam was built. Of high school students in an environmental studies class in Weaverville, they tried to bring attention to the plight of the salmon, and so they went out and had a mock funeral for the last salmon on the river. And that got picked up by the local news, and then the national news picked that up. It actually got attention. Congress got interested, brought in some funding, and started the first restoration efforts in 1975 because of this group of motivated students. So there was too much sand in the river, so they tried to build artificial spawning riffles and try to get the sand out by dragging the bulldozers up and down the river, dredging holes, and then they finally realized, well, maybe we should do some watershed restoration. So they built some sediment traps and stuff like that in the early 80s. But the fish were still struggling, and they weren't coming back with those efforts. And so the tribes basically, they have tribal fishing rights. And the federal government has to honor those. And so with the tribal pressure, basically they said, this isn't acceptable, you guys need to bring the fish back. And so the federal government started a 10-year study to say, well, what really is the problem? Since these restoration efforts aren't working, that study culminated in environmental documents and a record of decision that established the Trinity River Restoration Program. Essentially what they found was, this is a cross-section of a river in its normal state, and as the water levels go up and down, if you have this shallow edge water, as the water goes up and down this red zone, there's always a place for the little fish when they're this big. And but after the dam got built and the vegetation came in, it constrained the channel and it acts more like a canal, and you lose a lot of that habitat for the little fish. So it wasn't the spawning habitat, it's the rearing habitat that was really the problem. And so that's what they found, and then they established this restoration program, which is a multi-agency program. the historic fisheries facility, some of the fish meat. And strategy is to try to go about that by restoring actual river processes. Instead of going in and mechanically building the habitat, can we restore the processes that a normal river has, but just with less water? And then that's how you want it. That's what's going to restore the habitat. So this is a picture of 40 miles downstream of the dam. And this is the Trinity River here. North Fork Trinity River comes in there. Upstream, you can see it's a very simplified channel with vegetation kind of encroaching on either side. And then downstream, it's a very different kind of a river. There's vegetation, but it's patchy. You've got riffles, you've got bars, you've got pools, you've got a whole suite of habitat over here that the fish can use. And the difference between here and here is the North Fork, which supplies water and sediment. And so that's really what we're trying to do with the restoration program. Bring back more water, restore the sediment to the river, and it should act more like the river upstream. And so those are the major management actions: restore some flow releases, add some gravel, do some channel rehabilitation, and continue that watershed restoration. To do that, you need more water. So they authorized more water to flow down the Trinity River. So instead of 90%, now we have about 45% for restoration purposes. And then, so you start to bring flood cycles back into the river. And this is a river, the Trinity River is right back here. Then you engage these floodplains, and these are actually restored floodplains. And so that's really important. This provides lots of habitat for the fish, but the other thing it does is it pulls bugs and nutrients off of the floodplain back into the river and increases productivity so the fish have something to eat. It flushes sand, and some of that sand goes down the river, some of it deposits up on the floodplains and bars, and this makes great seedbeds for riparian vegetation to grow, which then brings more nutrients back into the river. Again, it also actually starts to change the character of the river. So here's a pre-flood photo, here's a post-flood photo. The blue lines are the same here, so you can see that the river bars are actually starting to engage and move around, and it's this process of a dynamic river that's important to build and maintain the habitat of the salmon. And you also start recruiting this dead wood off of the floodplain. It's actually a really important process for rivers and habitat. But these high flow releases that we do in the springtime come at a cost. I mean, we put water in people's backyards right up next to the house. So it's stressful for the community to bring back a flood cycle. We try to manage, obviously, we manage that, protect people's property. We add gravel to the river, and then here's the channel rehab project. This is in Junction City. This is before we did anything. I'm actually the designer of this project. So there's a nice spawning ripple right here. There's a nice paddle holding pool right here. There's no rearing habitat in this section. So how do you protect those nice things and bring rearing habitat in? The blue line is what the river looked like before. And what we did is we built a meander sequence up here, and then we built a series of wetlands, flowing wetlands over here, another wetland over here. We lowered all this so it will flood when the river comes up, and then we built some log dams and stuff like that you can't see. So that's what we did. Here's a different project where the river used to just be this straight shot right down here, and we basically filled in half the channel. Built another bypass channel over here, and there's a side panel that comes up here, there's over the left hand over there. And then this gravel bar naturally deposited after the first flood. So those are the kind of mechanical things that we do. And this is just a chart of the rearing habitat for the little fish. This is sort of system-wide average. This is the average at the sites that we construct beforehand, and then after we're done. So you basically pick the sites with low rearing habitat, and after you get done with the rest of it. something going on. This is the number of juvenile fish leaving the system every year. We have records back to the late 80s, and this is when our restoration efforts started, when we started putting more water in the river and started doing the restoration efforts. It had a positive effect. When the drought hit, things started to drop off. And that's it.
So what's the long-term outlook? How does it look for going forward?
It's uncertain. We're definitely improving conditions in the river, but the salmon, you know, they spawn in the river, then they go off to the ocean for 3 to 5 years and they come back. And so I showed you the graph that there's more, we're producing more juvenile fish, but we're not actually getting the adult fish back. And so part of that could be, you know, the drought. Part of that could be there's been horrible ocean conditions. Part of that is the conditions, the Trinity comes into the Klamath River 40 miles upstream of the ocean, and the Klamath River is awful, and especially in the summertime. It's got really bad water quality problems. You're not even supposed to let your dogs in there. And it has disease issues. It's really hot. So there's probably some issues there that we need to address. The jury's still out. We're doing some good things, but is it enough? And we need to find those, where that disconnect is in terms of the adults. Because that's what people care about. People don't care about little fish, they care about some big catch.
So. Yeah,
okay, sure. Any other questions?
I have a question.
Yeah.
When you make those S turns and stuff like that, when you're trying to build those spawning areas or those juvenile areas, are you studying how the river's gonna kind of wash that away and change the flow of that and then move your spawning area, or does it naturally just kind of move along with the river as you?
Ideally, if this was a totally unconstrained river and like up in Alaska kind of river, you know, those gravel bars would be moving down through the system over time. But the Trinity River is too constrained. It has too many of these historical impacts, and we don't actually have floods big enough to have that level of impact anymore. And so the bars that we build, they might shift around left to right, but they're not going to be like pushing the stream so much. And one of the things that's unique about the Trinity program is pretty much river restoration across the country is you go in and you build something. It's like you build it and it better be there, you know, 20 years from now, whatever. People think that success in river restoration is that whatever you built looks the same 20 years from now. And that's not actually very good for the ecosystem. And so on the Trinity River, one thing that sets it apart is they're trying to restore river processes, and that means we want a river that's dynamic and ever shifting. So the stuff that we build, we actually want, we release high flows to actually change it and make it different than how we built it. That said, you still build it to try to accommodate that, not just blow out and go back to what it was before. Yeah. So it's a balancing.
Awesome, thank you.
Yeah.
Seems like your focus is just on the Trinity. Is there anybody working on the Klamath?
There is work being done on the Klamath. The biggest thing going right now is to try to take out 4 dams on the Klamath, and that will significantly improve the water quality and disease issues. There's also restoration work on higher up in the Klamath River and in some tributaries. So there's quite a bit of work. My focus is on. Yeah.
Your last graph in 2006, it looked like it took a pretty significant dip. I was just wondering, as far as the juveniles that were being counted, I was just wondering, is that just sampling, or is it actually
that was just a sampling issue? Yeah. It was a really high flow year, so it's hard to sample. I think we're done.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thanks.
Thank you.